This episode of Musical Hell is brought to you by Midnight Musicals. Welcome to the podcast Musical Underground. Thank you. Yes, I know there's still Patreon requests on the docket. They can wait. I'm in charge of this court, this is my anniversary, and we are finally going to do the Superman musical.
What?
Yes, you heard right, my children. Long before Spider-Man had boys falling from the sky in more ways than one, there was our next offender. It's a bird, it's a plane, it's Superman. And like the later production, it also had seemingly promising pedigree. The score was by Charles Strauss, composer of probably the most popular comic-based musical ever. The book, written by future Superman screenwriters David Newman and Robert Burton, followed the same aesthetic as the hugely popular Batman television series. And the original production was produced and directed by none other than Hal Prince, who in 1966 was already a major player on Broadway and, with Cabaret debuting later that year, would only become more formidable. But, as is often the case, all this name power didn't translate into actual success, and the show limped through a mere 4-month run. But a couple of regional productions, now with the title shortened to just Superman, and several recordings of the signature song You've Got Possibilities kept it in the public consciousness long enough to bring about this made-for-television adaptation in 1975, with a truncated book and score and a lot to answer for. So let's examine the case of, you know, let's just call it Superman to make things easier. This being a comic book-based property, what better way to start than with an overly dramatic narrator?
Deceitful glamour boy columnist for the Metropolis Daily Planet.
I hate Superman. Big show-off. Well, I like monogrammed shirts as well as the next guy. But that big red S. Superman.
Okay, there are probably lots of better ways to start. Say, any way that doesn't involve our main characters looking at the fourth wall and declaring their motivations to us. You need some Shakespeare-level writing to pull that kind of thing off, and this isn't it. Having introduced our main characters, Lois Lane, egotistical columnist Max Mencken, Max's gal Friday Sydney, and local mad scientist Abner Sedgwick, the narrator gives a brief rundown of Superman's backstory for anyone who doesn't know it. So, two people maybe? No matter, after all the Zack Snyder super angst, it's kind of refreshing to see a Ma and Pa Kent who are remarkably chill about their adopted son's abilities.
Oh, baby Clark has smashed through the nursery wall again.
The little Dickens.
But young Clark quickly undergoes a case of dead parent syndrome, and so sets out to Metropolis to fight for truth at all. Which brings us to the story proper, our first song, and sin number two, We Need Him.
He saved my baby from a fire.
Saved my baby from a fire. Yes, he did. Yes, he did.
He caught the thug that was mugging Uncle Meyer.
The first chorus number does not bode well for the rest of the movie. First, there's the orchestrations, which have been reworked to fit the 1970s mold. If you're going to update the sound of a song, you need to have the skill to justify it. When Whitney Houston sang Rodgers and Hammerstein's Impossible in her riff-heavy R&B style, it worked because not only did she have the talent to pull it off, but because she was Whitney fucking Houston, and it wouldn't make sense to have her sing in the same manner as, say, Bernadette Peters. Just throwing in a bunch of electric guitars and drums doesn't add a new twist to the song, it just makes you sound desperate to appeal to the kids these days. Then there's the choreography, which is rather dull and mostly involves singing to the camera. I mean, if you want to see that, there's been more than enough videos over the past year to accommodate that need. In the Daily Planet newsroom, most of our main characters are going about their usual daily business. Lois is alternating between mooning over Superman and blithely ignoring Clark's existence. Sydney is yelling at Max for standing her up again, and Max is using his platform to air his personal grievances.
What scarlet cape schlemiel with an S on his chest is becoming a menace to commercial aviation?
Hope they don't hear about Max's routine in the Marvelverse. That J. Jonah Jameson seems like the litigious type. Elsewhere, Superman's downfall is being plotted in one of those abandoned warehouses that are so essential to criminal activity.
I pledge allegiance to the mobs of the United Hoods of the Underworld.
Yes, the rejects from Nathan Detroit's crap game get old really fast, but it could be worse. In the original musical, they were a troupe of Chinese acrobats with names like Ming Fu Ling. Yeah. Anyway, the head mafioso is putting out a hit on Superman, and he gives his thugs 1 week to do the job, or else. Sounds like someone has never heard of actionable goals. But first, an ode to capitalism.
It's a rich country full of all the trusting souls. It's a swell country without no gun controls.
The fact that this song could easily have been written yesterday is both very impressive and very, very depressing. Our actual antagonist, Dr. Sedgwick, is also commencing on his Destroy Superman plot, which begins with him seeking out Superman's favorite damsel in distress.
Oh, you're too modest! Why, when anybody speaks of the Metropolis Institute of Technology, they really mean Dr. Abner Sedgwick.
Our intrepid reporter, ladies and gentlemen! Sin number three, I really, really dislike Lois's characterization in this. Look, I know comic book canon is a vast and multifaceted universe, so I can believe that somewhere out there there's a basis for portraying Lois as a simpering flake with no thought in her tiny little mind beyond becoming Mrs. Kal-El. But that doesn't make it a good idea. Does anybody really want a Lois Lane whose big solo involves her indulging in a somewhere that's green-esque domestic fantasy?
Green stamps in a book.
I wish we could have seen Leslie Ann Warren play Lois with the wit we all know she's capable of. This dumb brunette act is embarrassing for the both of us. Sedgwick explains to Lois that there's a death ray at the local university that was originally designed to quell student uprisings, but now it's gone haywire and threatens to destroy the entire city. He knows she's got an in with Superman and begs her to ask for his help, but Clark has overheard the entire thing and is out the door before Lois can look up Superman in her Rolodex. With Superman on the way, Sedgwick explains to the fourth wall that everything is going according to plan.
Soon he will face a ray so powerful that even on its shakedown test, it was capable of obliterating an Internal Revenue agent at a range of 1,000 miles.
At the university, Superman bursts through the wall, Batman would have at least used the window, and quickly punches the death ray into submission. Undeterred, Sedgwick explains that everything is still going according to plan.
Oh, he's a great hero now, but the higher he flies, the further he has to fall.
And he expounds on his motivation, which is that he wants to take over the world so he can destroy Sweden, which has snubbed him for the Nobel Prize one too many times. And finally, we get some good old-fashioned mad scientist scenery chewing.
10 times I was runner-up. 10 times! But always. Hey, been sorry, Dr. Sedgwick, but you blew it again. Look at me. Look at me! A 10-time Nobel Prize loser!
Which, unfortunately, leads into sin number four, revenge.
Revenge! Revenge! I'll have it on them all. No single slight will I forget. I'll show no mercy, you can bet.
This doesn't say evil mad scientist to me. It's more like dopey sidekick nobody likes. Speak of the Angel, Max has overheard the entire rant and wants in on Sedgwick's Destroy Superman plot. As once Superman's out of the way, Max will be the most popular man in Metropolis and also have unobstructed access to Lois. Sedgwick tells Max to meet him at his laboratory in 1 hour. This means Max has to break off his date with Sydney, who is none too pleased about it. Come on, if you really wanted to commit to the comic book aesthetic, you should have given her Grawlixes. Sydney's had it with Max and decides to flirt with Clark instead by means of the score's only popular song.
You've got possibilities, though you're horribly square.
Meanwhile, the random mafia guys have figured out that their usual tactic of shooting bullets at the problem isn't going to help in this case. But they figure a guy who can design a death ray might have some better ideas, so they go to pay Sedgwick a visit. Sedgwick, meanwhile, is describing his latest diabolical plan, or maybe his original diabolical plan, version 1.3, to Max.
The way to destroy Superman is to have Superman destroy himself.
You mean to say that Superman would destroy himself?
I mean to say that Superman would destroy himself.
Ah, I see. You mean that Superman...
Finally, Sedgwick explains that there will be a ceremony honoring Superman for the whole Death Ray destroying thing, and reasons that by causing a calamity to befall the city just as its protector is receiving accolades, the public can be persuaded to turn against him. With a little help from Max's journalistic influence, of course.
Well, he couldn't take it. He'd fall apart. He'd collapse inwardly. Ergo, he would...
Wait a minute. Superman would destroy...
Oh, shut up.
The gleeful villains get their music glowed on, and if you thought Revenge was a disappointing villain song, you ain't heard nothing yet.
Your pop's in my book, Cookie, my head is happening.
You're Mickey Mouse.
May the ghost of Cole Porter haunt you forever for stealing that lyric. Oh, look, the villain plots have finally intersected. Generic mafia guys declare they're kidnapping Sedgwick to force him to work on the Destroying Superman issue, but since he's already working on that life goal, he enlists them as henchmen instead. Meanwhile, Clark and Lois are... kissing?
Oh, Clark, have you been there all along?
Yeah, you just never noticed. I guess it was going out and talking to Sydney that changed me.
Yeah, turns out Clark and Sydney didn't really click because she realized he was really crazy about Lois and gave him the courage to approach her, and Lois has realized that maybe the awkward but kind normal guy might be a better fit for her than the remote, unapproachable superhero, and sin number 7, maybe we should have had scenes actually showing these things happening rather than getting them hastily exposited at us. Sedgwick sends his new goons to put his evil plan into action, which involves a cartoon bomb under Metropolis City Hall. The explosion is set to detonate just as Superman is getting the university campus laundry named in his honor, at a ceremony attended by a bunch of adoring students and a couple of metafictional characters.
Pretty keen shirts. Where'd you get them?
Joe here did it.
Oh, come on, Jerry.
Tell him. I'm an
artist. In case that went by too fast, these two guys are named after, and kind of implied to be, Superman creators Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster. They will be back later. Just as Superman is making an awkward speech about protecting truth, justice, etc., City Hall is blown up and Max wastes no time channeling his inner Tucker Carlson.
Where was Superman?
Huh? Why did he fail to stop this terrible catastrophe? Oh, my fellow Americans, it is at a time like this when I wish I were sitting there in Washington in that Oval Office.
The crowd turns on Superman, and Max is delighted. Sydney is distinctly unimpressed, however, and gets so into her frankly terrific pay-on to Max's self-love that she doesn't even notice him being kidnapped.
You do something to you. No one can go.
It turns out Sedgwick has a computer that has been working on determining Superman's secret identity. Which, you know, is something you'd think he'd want to figure out before working on the whole Destroy Superman thing. Not that it matters, as the computer has put together 2 and 2 and come up with Euler's number.
You can, Max Behnken, or should I say, Superman?
Don't shoot! Oh, don't shoot, Doc! That jerk computer's wrong! Wrong!
The computer says, it's never wrong.
But it doesn't take them too long to rule Max out of the equation, leading them to pretty much the only other male reporter on the Daily Planet staff. Now armed with Superman's secret identity, the two of them go into the final phase of the Destroy Superman plot and head to Clark Kent's apartment. Superman happens to be there now, moping around the house in his tights and singing lounge numbers with way too much echo effect.
Why must the strongest man in the world? Tell me why.
Sedgwick's coup de grace, I am almost embarrassed to admit this, involves giving Superman a quick psychoanalyst session in which Sedgwick declares the Man of Steel to be a sick freak and leaves him quivering with doubt and self-loathing. It was the 1970s. Mental trauma was funny.
Did it ever occur to you that that X-ray vision is just another word for voyeurism?
I've been going easy on Sedgwick's evil plan, which largely seems to have been made up as he went along, but this is the final straw. This idea was probably clever and topical in the 60s and 70s, when the mental health field was just beginning to evolve into its current form. But boy, listening to Superman whine while Lois tries in vain to boost his self-esteem has not aged well.
Now nobody loves me.
Oh, Superman, that's not true. Well, everybody loves you. Mm-hmm. Oh, no.
If I wanted to hear a neurotic dope complain about his life to a woman who's inexplicably attracted to him, I'd watch a Woody Allen movie. Lois is unable to snap Superman out of his funk before the thugs arrive for her regularly scheduled kidnapping. This proves to be the last straw for Superman, who decides to throw himself off a bridge. It was the 1970s. Suicide was also funny. Meanwhile, Lois is escorted into Sedgwick's laboratory.
Oh, Dr. Sedgwick, thank heavens you're here!
Yeah, not the brightest crystal in the Fortress of Solitude, this particular Lois. Although she does get to sing the villains the riot act.
We'll end your lives in jail. Good will triumph, don't forget.
The plan is to blow up the lab and all its incriminating evidence with Lois inside, but a betrayal pile-up of Westerosian proportions ensues when Sedgwick decides he no longer needs Max and ties him to the detonator, which will go off if Max moves too much, and the thugs decide they're done with Sedgwick and tie him up too. Fortunately, Superman has remembered he can't actually drown, and Joe and Jerry, remember them, come by and encourage the Man of Steel to let his freak flag fly.
There's nothing wrong with being a freak.
That's right. Just means you're a little different than the rest.
Different, you mean better?
No. Just like more so.
Right. Like, take Michelangelo. Only a freak would have taken 4 years just to paint a ceiling.
The metafictional support gives Superman his mojo back, and he flies off to save the day. The thugs put up a fight, but they're no match for 70s funk powers.
You boys, pow, what good damn. I like a crook who really tries. Come on, pow, let's go. You'll learn a trick or two.
Superman carries Lois off, promising to return for the villains later. Unfortunately for them, Max has come down with a bad case of the hiccups.
Let me scare you.
What's scared? I'm terrified already.
But it all ends well. The blast just ends up giving Max and Sedgwick amnesia, causing them to forget both Superman's secret identity and all their evil tendencies. Max has proposed to Sydney, and Sedgwick is working the Daily Planet science beat and gunning for a Pulitzer. Lois still finds herself torn between Clark and Superman, but no matter, there's always days to save.
It looks like a job for...
Superman!
The best part of Superman is Charles Strauss's score, which does have some genuine gems, even if they're hobbled by the arrangements. The main problem is the book, at least in this film adaptation, which is, if you'll pardon the expression, an unholy mess, and one that is embarrassingly outdated in a lot of places. Therefore, the Court of Musical Hell orders the following punishments. For messing up Strauss's score with the bad funk arrangements, we condemn Fred Werner to eat steak smothered with Hershey's syrup. For the clumsy, jumbled-up adaptation, Romeo Muller is condemned to search a Where's Waldo illustration with Waldo removed. And finally, for their villainous ineptitude, Abner Sedgwick and Max Mencken are condemned to each other.
You mean to say that Superman would destroy himself?
I mean to say that Superman...
Yeah, you get the picture. So let it be recorded. This session of the Infernal Court in Musical Hell is now adjourned.